الله الرحمن الرحيم. صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله وعلى أهل بيتك المظلومين. صلى الله عليك أيتها الصديقة الشهيدة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين. صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة يا غريب يا شهيد كربلاء، فيا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. I begin in the name of the Almighty God, the Compassionate, the Merciful, the one who has created everything in utmost perfection. And may the peace and blessings of the Almighty God be upon His pure and beloved Messenger, the peak of His creation, the symbol of humanity, the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, and His immaculate progeny of the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, especially the leader of our time, the awaited Savior, Al-Imam Al-Mahdi, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajah. May Allah hasten his reappearance and make us all amongst his sincere and dedicated servants. Dear brothers and sisters, on this very tragic day, I extend to you my sincerest condolences on the martyrdom of the leader of the women of the world, the daughter of the great prophet and apostle of God, Lady Fatima salawatullahi alayha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Holy Quran, in Surah Al-A'raf, verse 176, فَقْصُصِ الْقَصَصَ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. O Prophet, share previous stories of previous nations with your people so they contemplate. Whenever we commemorate the martyrdom of this great lady, Fatima salamullahi alayha, we are reminded of the tragic attack that took place on her house. We cannot detach the incident of the door from her martyrdom. And every single year, we commemorate this tragic incident. But there are two very important questions here. Number one, why is it that we bring this incident up every single year? Some people object or question and say that, does this not lead to sectarian tensions? Doesn't the Holy Quran command us as Muslims to unite? Why discuss anything that could threaten this unity or arouse any sectarian tensions? That's the first question. The second question is, many Muslims, especially from other schools of thought, they ask, is it even possible that an attack like this could happen on the house of Fatima? How could any companion do that? We just cannot fathom and digest that. It doesn't make any sense for any of the companions to attack the very daughter of their messenger. Even if you bring us 20, 50, 60, 70 sources, we simply cannot fathom and accept that such thing could logically even happen. Our discussion today will revolve around these two very important questions. And then towards the end, we will briefly examine the logistics of the house of Fatima alayhi salam. Where exactly was it situated so we can better understand how the attack happened and we can visualize it? Let's now address the first question, my dear brothers and sisters. Why is it that we discuss a historical event when it could potentially lead to any tension? Our guideline in our life is the Holy Quran. The Holy Quran teaches us to discuss history. It's very appropriate to discuss history. It's a Quranic principle. You find that the Holy Quran frequently brings up the events of previous nations. For instance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings up the actions of the Jewish nation and how they treated their prophets. And the Holy Quran addresses the Jews who were living at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi, and rebukes them for what their ancestors did. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in chapter 2 of the Quran, verse 92 states, that's Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 92, وَلَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مُوسَى بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ Moses brought clear signs to you. But what did you do? ثُمَّ اتَّخَذْتُمُ الْعِجْلَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ وَأَنْتُمْ ظَالِمُونَ Then you took the calf after him, meaning you worshipped the calf, that golden calf, and you were oppressors. Now the people who worshipped the calf, none of them were present at the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi. They had all passed away. But the Quran seems to be addressing the Jewish communities at the time and pretty much holding them responsible for that. Why does the Quran do that? Because they had not dissociated from the acts of their ancestors. They had not condemned it. They were okay with what their previous ancestors had done. But the Quran holds them responsible. The Quran addresses them. Now, my dear brothers and sisters, one could argue, was this really necessary? You have a Jewish community in Medina, and even though the Prophet was respectful towards them, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi signed a document with them as we examined last night. But why did the Prophet in the Holy Quran have to arouse negative sentiments? Imagine if you're a Jewish person living in Medina and you hear a verse like that, that you were oppressors when you worshiped the calf. Those Jewish communities could have said, we have nothing to do with that. We never did that. And why are you even using this type of tone? But this is a Quranic principle. We have to understand what happened in our history so we can now live a proper present. If I do not dissociate myself from the evil actions of previous nations, even if they were my ancestors, then I will not understand my religion properly and I will commit the same mistakes that they committed. So the Holy Quran commands us to contemplate history so we don't go astray. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi had warned this ummah about a similar trajectory. Didn't God show so many signs to the Jewish people at the time of Moses? Yet many of them deviated. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi warned this ummah that the same exact thing will happen with this ummah. Take these two sources as an example. Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. These two prominent books of hadith that our Sunni brothers and sisters hold in high regard. There in Bukhari and Muslim, a narration is narrated from Abu Sa'id, one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi. He said that the Prophet said the following, لَتَتَّبِعُنَّ سُنَنَ مَنْ قَبْلَكُمْ شِبْرًا بِشِبْرٍ You will follow the tradition and the path of those before you, inch by inch, in today's words. Shibr is basically the span of your hand. Inch by inch, you'll follow them. وَذِرَاعًا بِذِرَاعًا Arms length by arms length. To the point, the Prophet is saying this in Bukhari and Muslim, to the point, if those previous nations had entered the hole of a lizard, you would have done the same thing. This is an Arabic expression, by the way, just to understand the context behind this hadith. That whatever they did, this ummah is also going to do. So he asked them, Ya Rasulullah, who are you referring to? The Jews and the Christians? The Prophet said, yes, of course. Then who else? those previous nations, what happened after their prophets brought them the path of guidance? Many of them went astray. Many of them deviated. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam tells us that this ummah is going to follow this, those previous nations inch by inch, we automatically know something disturbing happened after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. So it's okay to discuss that. What justifies censoring historical details when the Quran encourages us to examine previous nations and their history? And the Prophet has already warned us and foretold us that we will follow those paths. So disturbing things will happen in this ummah. Why are we not allowed to discuss that academically, respectfully? Look at Surah Al-Buruj, my dear brothers and sisters. One of the chapters in the Holy Quran. See how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala documents a historic event. قُتِلَ أَصْحَابُ الْأُخْدُودِ النَّارِ ذَاتِ الْوَقُودِ. God says the people of the pit were killed, mercilessly killed. They were burned. Why does the Quran have to bring that up? A group of believers, some sources indicate they were Christians. They were good, decent Christians. They were killed by an evil king. They were burned alive. The Holy Quran condemns that action. And it teaches us that when you see an act of injustice in history, you also dissociate yourself from it. You condemn it. So in our discussion today, my dear brothers and sisters, we will be academic. We don't intend to cause any sectarian tension. These are historical events that we are entitled to discuss. We want to make sense of how these events happened. That's the first question. And we know that according to the Quran, it's perfectly okay to discuss historical events. That's number one. The second question. We can go on listing the various historical sources that confirm an attack happened on the house of Lady Fatima alayhi salam. But my dear brothers and sisters, and this is a fundamental point, especially when we discuss this with Muslims from other schools of thought. But if we have a mental or psychological barrier from fathoming such an incident and how it could happen, it won't really help to just keep mentioning the sources. If something seems implausible to me, that it cannot happen, even if you show me hundreds of sources, maybe I won't accept it because I have a mental psychological barrier. And so many Muslims ask, how could something like that happen? Didn't these companions hear the Prophet praising his daughter Fatima? Doesn't Bukhari state that the Prophet said, Fatima is a part of me. Whoever angers her has angered me. Didn't they witness miracles during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam? Now you want me 14 centuries later to believe that some of these companions attacked his own daughter? And not just any companion, because as we shall see in the sources, some very prominent companions that are held in high regard in other schools of thought were present there at the scene. For instance, Umar ibn al-Khattab, in almost all sources, was present there by the door when the incident happened, or he was leading the group to the house of Lady Fatima alayhi salam. So many Muslims say, I simply cannot fathom that. How could they make such a threat to Lady Fatima alayhi salam? I simply cannot accept that these companions who spent years with the Prophet, they could do something like that. My dear brothers and sisters, to understand this fundamental question here, it's also helpful to go back and see what happened in previous ummas, in previous nations. Because the Prophet tells us in Bukhari and Muslim that everything that happened in previous nations will happen in this ummah. Let's see what happened briefly in previous nations to see if such a thing is even possible. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in chapter 2, Surah Al-Baqarah, in verse 47, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the Bani Israel. And Allah praises the Bani Israel, the Jewish nation, the children of Israel. God praises them in the Holy Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in verse 47, Ya Bani Israel, adhkuru ni'mati allati an'amtu alaykum. Remember my favors upon you, O children of Israel. Wa anni faddaltukum ala al-alamin. Allah says, I have favored you over all other worlds and nations and people. during that time. This is a big praise from the Almighty God in the Holy Quran for the children of Israel. And they saw many, many signs. They saw the sea being split. Can you imagine a tangible miracle greater than an entire ocean or sea being split? Can you imagine a stronger miracle from God than that? After all those miracles, this nation, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises in the Holy Quran, that at the time, you were the best of nations. What happened? What did they do? They worshiped the calf. As soon as Allah saved them from the Pharaoh and they saw all the miracles, they deviated and they worshiped the calf, the golden calf. They took it as their God. And Allah rebukes them for doing that in the Holy Quran. And they started to kill prophets. Verse 61 of chapter 2. وَيَقْتُلُونَ النَّبِيِّينَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍّ The Quran says they started to kill prophets, not ordinary people. Prophets without any justification. And this is after all those miracles, as we mentioned. Verse 61 talks about some of these miracles. How God brought down the men and the salwa, the heavenly foods. God sends Bani Israel foods from heaven, from the clouds. And yet after that, what do? They kill prophets. Didn't this happen to previous nations? Well, if this happened to previous nations, and the prophet is telling us, everything that happened in previous nations is going to happen in this nation. Why would it be impossible for us to accept that disturbing things happened after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Remember, an important political situation arose after the Prophet. There was a group who wanted to rule. They did not want Imam Ali alayhi salam to rule for many reasons, but the point is they did not want the Imam to rule. Now, when you look at the sources, my dear brothers and sisters, we do find that there were companions of the Prophet present by the door, by the incident of the door, when the attack happened. And the sources all indicate, and I say this with academic respect for historical references, without any intention to arouse any sectarian differences, my dear brothers and sisters. All the sources confirm that Umar ibn al-Khattab was there at the scene when the incident happened. Now, for Umar ibn al-Khattab, the political circumstances were very crucial because he wanted to solidify the caliphate of Abu Bakr. For him, that was the priority. So if it meant that he has to step inside the house of Fatima, to bring Imam Ali alayhi salam to give allegiance, yes, he would. For him, that would be politically justified. But now the question here is that many Muslims struggle with, but is it possible for him to do something like that, to enter a house, for a physical attack to be inflicted on Lady Fatima, on the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, for him to order such an attack? Is that even possible? Can a companion like that even think of doing something like that? Today, if you, my dear brothers and sisters, are told that a community member, a well-known community member, has attacked a woman, how do you react to that? Well, you look at the history of this community member, right? If this community member, I will borrow now an example, and I know my dear brother Mahbub Suji is going to forgive me for this example, but just to bring the idea closer to you. Imagine if today you hear in the community that brother Mahbub Suji has physically attacked a woman. What's the first reaction? The first thing you're going to say is, no, this is impossible. Why? Because never in our lives have we heard that brother Mahbub has laid a finger on a woman to physically assault her. So no, of course, we're not going to accept that. These are just rumors. Even if people come and tell me, Islam tells you, ignore the rumors. Because you know brother Mahbub, you've seen his decency. You know that never in his life has he done something like that. But let's say it was another figure in the community, not brother Mahbub, someone else, who's had a history of physically assaulting a woman for whatever reason. And then you're told that this person has attacked a woman. Now, would it become impossible for you to accept it or no? Think about this example, my dear brothers and sisters. If there is a person who's had a history of inflicting physical assault on women, would it then be impossible for you to believe that this person ordered an attack because he had a political goal, because he had a political agenda? It was a very important agenda for him. Now, I would like to share with you two examples from the life of Umar ibn al-Khattab, so we can shed light on whether it was even possible for him, for a companion like him, to order an attack on the house of Fatima. If you look at Sunni sources of history, such as Ibn Asakir, Ibn Sa'd in his Tabaqat, Al-Bayhaqi, Al-Hakim al-Naysaburi, Ibn Ishaq, Tabarani, these are all sources which have documented this incident. That in the sixth year of the Bi'tha of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after he declared the message of Islam, you know, the fifth or sixth year, a number of Muslims left to Abyssinia, to Habasha. This made Umar boil with rage. He had not become Muslim yet at that time. He was in Mecca. He was still an idol worshiper. He becomes very enraged. He said, look at this man, Muhammad. What is he doing? He's destroying our society to the point where some of our own people had to flee Mecca and go to Abyssinia. This is unacceptable. These Sunni sources state that he took out his sword and he went to confront the Prophet. And his idea was, let me kill him and get rid of him. On his way to see the Prophet, he met one of his friends. He told him, what are you doing? Why do you have your sword unsheathed? He said, well, I am going to get rid of this Muhammad. He told him, you want to kill Muhammad when your own family has become Muslim, your own sister? He had a sister who had become Muslim, her and her husband. Your sister and your brother-in-law have become Muslim. And you're trying to go and kill Muhammad? That doesn't make any sense. Umar becomes infuriated. He goes to the house of his sister. Now, some say that his sister, her name was Fatima. Some historical accounts have mentioned that her name is Fatima, subhanAllah. He has a sister by the name of Fatima. Fatima was a common name even before Islam. He goes to his sister and he discovers that she and her husband are learning the Holy Quran and that they have become Muslim. He becomes so enraged. He beats his brother-in-law. And then he physically assaults his own sister such that she starts to bleed. And then these historical accounts say that he read the Quran, he went and he saw the Prophet, and then he declared his Islam. But the point is, he actually assaulted his own sister because she had converted to the religion of Islam. And he found this unacceptable. So here is one precedent in the life of Umar ibn al-Khattab where he physically assaulted a woman. Now, you could say, my dear brothers and sisters, wait a minute, Sayyid, come on, this is in Mecca. This is when he was mushrik. Later, he became a Muslim. He followed the path of the Prophet. He's not going to something like that after he became Muslim. Well, let's go 23 years forward, or actually 17, 18 years forward. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi passes away. Abu Bakr rules for 2 years. He passes away. When Abu Bakr dies, Aisha, the daughter of Abu Bakr, she has a group of women in her own house crying and mourning for the death of Abu Bakr, the caliph. Umar was disturbed by that. This is documented in very well-known Sunni sources. Bukhari mentions the incident very briefly, but then you have Ibn Sa'd in his Tabaqat, you have Tabari, you have Ibn al-Athir that give us some more details. Umar was disturbed because Umar believed that it's a sin for women to cry. You can't just gather there and cry and cry. You can't do that. It's haram. That was his understanding. Of course, this is not the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Umar had a problem with women crying. And interestingly, Bukhari has this hadith under an independent chapter, a separate chapter. You know what the chapter, what Bukhari titles this chapter? He says, Babu ikhraji ahl al-ma'asi wal-khusum min al-buyut. This chapter is dedicated to evicting and kicking out sinful people from their rooms, from their homes. And then Bukhari says, This happened when Umar kicked out the sister of Abu Bakr when she cried. Bukhari leaves it at that. He doesn't really go into details. But other Sunni sources, such as Ibn Sa'd and his Tabaqat, have mentioned to us exactly what happened. And many Sunni scholars have regarded this chain of transmission as a sahih hadith. What did Umar ibn al-Khattab do, my dear brothers and sisters? The hadith narrates that he came at the door of the house of Aisha. And he told the woman, stop crying. If you don't stop crying, I will physically discipline you. Aisha told him, I do not give you permission to come to my house. You cannot enter my house. I don't give you that permission. He gave them a last warning. And then he entered the house. And then with his dirra, with his stick, he began to beat Farwa, who is the sister of Abu Bakr, and other women, one by one, kicking them out. My dear brothers and sisters, this is not the book of Kafi. This is in Bukhari and these other sources. Bukhari mentions it very briefly. These other sources tell us exactly what happened. So this is after he had become Muslim. And my dear brothers and sisters, he did not beat any ordinary people. He beat the sister of the Khalifa, of Abu Bakr, sister Farwa. Because he was disturbed by the fact that they were crying. I would say to our fellow Muslims, my dear brothers and sisters, please open your hearts and examine this piece of evidence here. If Umar ibn al-Khattab is willing to hit the sister of Abu Bakr, this is years after he became Muslim. This is the day he became caliph. He's now Khalifat al-Muslimin. If Umar ibn al-Khattab beats the sister of your Khalifa, why? Did she kill someone? No. Did she weaken his government? No. Did she cause disunity? No. Did she commit an indecent act? No. She cried. She was crying and weeping. Umar ibn al-Khattab found that inappropriate. Women should not weep like that over dead people, even if it's Abu Bakr. If Umar went to the extent of beating her physically, according to well-established Sunni sources, my dear brothers and sisters, how about if a woman is in his way and she is threatening him politically? She's challenging their authority. She's defending the imam of their time. You think now it's impossible for him to inflict a physical assault on her? If it comes to a trivial issue like crying on your Khalifa, Umar did have the audacity to go and physically discipline those women. Now, when it comes to an opposition, and we know what people do in governments, if there's an opposition who's not recognizing my government and my legitimacy, that's huge. That's the most important thing and priority for you now. So yes, my dear brothers and sisters, what happened is that Imam Ali alayhi salam refused to give allegiance because he was appointed by the Prophet to be the successor. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam was in his house. The Imam alayhi salam, number one, was discussing with other members of Bani Hashim what to do. There's a coup d'etat. The caliphate has been usurped. What do we do about that? He was speaking to Salman, speaking to Abu Dhar, speaking to Ammar. Sources indicate Az-Zubayr. Sunni sources indicate Az-Zubayr was in the house of Imam Ali. Number two, the Imam alayhi salam was compiling the Quran. He was gathering the different scattered pages of the Quran into one book so that none of it gets lost. He has a priority now. After washing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, and after the prayer on the Prophet was done and after the Prophet was buried, Imam Ali's priority, now that he saw the Khilafah and the Caliphate was taken from him, Imam Ali's priority was now what? The Imam's priority was now to compile the Quran. The Imam was in his house. So they came to take him from the house. Why is it impossible for us to accept such a thing could happen? There was a very strong political motive here. See, when you look at history, brothers and sisters, We're not stuck on one source versus another source. We put the pieces together. When you put the pieces together, there is no shadow of a doubt that an attack happened on the house of Lady Fatima. Yes, we can disagree on the very small details. Is the book of Sulaym ibn Qais a reliable book or no? Maybe I can dispute some details here and there. Different scholars have different standards of accepting hadiths. But look at the big picture. Put the hundreds of clues together. Doesn't Al-Dhahabi, a prominent Sunni scholar, Al-Tabari, a prominent Sunni historian, tell us that when Abu Bakr was dying, he said that I regret ordering the attack on the house of Fatima. Something happened, brothers and sisters. Something tragic happened after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. Keep that in mind. Let us be open to accepting that the Ahlul Bayt were oppressed after the Prophet. Why do you think the Prophet says, no Prophet has been hurt as much as I have been hurt? And he asked for one thing from his ummah, al-mawaddata fil qurba. I ask you to just love and follow my family. That hurt the Prophet deeply to know what would happen to his ummah and how they would conspire against his own family. Now, my dear brothers and sisters, let's briefly look at the logistics of the house of Lady Fatima alayhi salam. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi migrated from Mecca to Medina, he spent some time in Quba waiting for Imam Ali alayhi salam and Lady Fatima to arrive. And then the Prophet entered Medina. At that time, it was called Yathrib. The people of Medina begged the Prophet to stay in their homes, to have the honor of hosting the Prophet. The Prophet said, my camel is being instructed by God to go where God wants it to go. So wherever the camel stops, that's where I will be staying. The camel goes and stops by the house of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, this great companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. So the Prophet stays for a while in the house of Abu Ayyub until his house and the house of Lady Fatima is constructed by the masjid. The mosque of the Prophet was being constructed. Adjacent to it, the rooms of the Prophet, the eastern side of the masjid, that's where the rooms of the Prophet and his wives and his daughter Lady Fatima were being constructed. So when Lady Fatima alayhi salam married Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, a small house was built for them. And when we say house, it was basically just a room that was divided into two, three parts. It wasn't really a house. Historians have given us the approximate dimensions of the house of Fatima. It was approximately 14 meters by 7.5 meters. That's 100 square meters, 100 square meters. The entire house of Lady Fatima with the opening, with, you know, their private room and then their guest room. All of that was just 100 square meters. But it was relatively bigger than the rooms of the other wives of the Prophet, such as Aisha, Salama, and the others. The house of Lady Fatima was situated to the east of the Masjid of the Prophet. So if you're standing towards the Qibla, facing south to Mecca and the Masjid of the Prophet, the house of Fatima alayhi salam is to your left. It was carpeted with sand to make this the ground soft. That's how humble the Imam was. He did not have a fancy Persian rug. It was just carpeted with dust. And the Prophet would spend a lot of time in the house of Fatima. He would pray Salat al-Layl over there. He would do Tahajjud over there. And he would also go there to relax from the difficulties of life. In fact, Aisha narrates in one hadith, she says, one day I saw the Prophet. He was so affected by hunger, near starvation. So I saw him wearing his cloak, getting ready to go out. I told him, Ya Rasulullah, where are you going? He said, I'm going to the house of Fatima. Why? What's going on there? The Prophet told Aisha, whenever I see Hassan and Hussein, I forget my hunger. I'm so hungry right now. I want to see Hassan and Hussein. Because when I see them, I forget about my pain. I forget about my suffering. The house of Lady Fatima was the sanctuary for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi. And here's the fundamental point, my dear brothers and sisters. If you look at the map of the house of Fatima, historical references indicate it had only one door. And that door opened into the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi. All the other rooms they had either one or two doors. For those rooms that had two doors, one room would open into the mosque of the Prophet, another room would open into the alley, into the street of Medina. Except the house of Lady Fatima alayhi salam. To the east, you have the Masjid of the Prophet, wall to wall. To the left, you had the house of Salama. The only way to get to the house of Fatima was either through the Masjid, you directly enter it, or you go into the house of Salama from the street. Then from the house of Salama, a door opened to the house of Lady Fatima. That's the logistics of the house. And now you understand how Allah showed the virtue of the house of Fatima when God commanded all other companions to close the doors they had directly opening into the mosque. Before, they would just come from their room into the mosque. Allah banned that, except the house of Ali. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated the household of Imam Ali, Imam Ali alayhi salam, can leave from his room, come into the mosque. So whenever Imam Hassan, Imam Hussein, Imam Ali alayhi salam wanted to leave the house, their exit was into the mosque of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Now, my dear brothers and sisters, you better understand how the attack happened and which door Fatima opened. According to these historical reports and this historical analysis, it wasn't a door that was situated on the street. No, they came from inside the Masjid of the Prophet, where the Prophet would stand every day, knocking on the door, seeking permission. Where he would stand there and recite the verse of purification after Allah had revealed it. All Muslims had seen that. So yes, my dear brothers and sisters, Imam Ali is sitting in his house. He's compiling the Quran. He was discussing important things with Bani Hashim. They came, they knocked at the door. Lady Fatima alayhi salam opened the door. Some people say, why would Imam Ali let his wife open the door? Why did the Prophet allow his wives to open the door? Look at our sources, Sunni and Shia sources. Sometimes people would come, they would knock at the door of the Prophet. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi was preoccupied with something. He would tell his wives to open the door. Imam Ali is following the Sunnah of the Prophet. And he was commanded by the Prophet that you sit in your house until the entire Quran is compiled. He's following the will of the Prophet. So at that point, they come and they tell Lady Fatima, they knock on the door, Lady Fatima alayhi salam, she goes to open the door. And remember, historical accounts tell us that she was not even wearing the full veil. That means the attack happened so suddenly. Some of us have this image that Imam Ali is just sitting there and just watching, not doing anything, not caring. No, the Imam was in another corner of the room. He was implementing the will of the Prophet by compiling the Quran. They come, they knock at the door. Lady Fatima goes from behind the door. She tells them, what do you want? They said, we have come for Ali. She says, no, Ali's not going to come. They told her, then we'll attack you. We have to get Ali to pledge allegiance. It's an important political matter. Lady Fatima alayhi salam said, but Fatima, the daughter of the Prophet, is here. You guys are in the Masjid of the Prophet. How would you dare do something like that? They said, so what? We have a political agenda. We have to follow through. Within seconds, the attack happened. And don't forget, my dear brothers and sisters, Imam Ali was the Imam of her time. Every mu'min, every believer is always commanded by God to defend the Prophet of your time and the Imam of your time. Didn't Lady Zainab try to defend Imam Zain al-Abidin? How many of you have heard the stories of Karbala where Shimr tried to kill Imam Zain al-Abidin? Lady Zainab would come and protect him. Now someone could say, how come Imam Zain al-Abidin is not defending his aunt? My dear brothers and sisters, it was her obligation to defend Imam Zain al-Abidin because he was the Imam of her time. That's by the instruction of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Imam Hussein instructed his son, regardless of what happens, you don't fight. You don't fight. You're instructed by God not to fight. Allah wants this lineage to continue. Yes. When the incident happened and Lady Fatima alayhi salam yelled for help, Imam Ali came like a lion rushing to the scene. And there are details that happened there. I invite you to go and read the books of history. So my dear brothers and sisters, a tragic event did happen in the city of Medina. We have to be open to these historical references and what happened to this young daughter of Lady Fatima, of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi, Lady Fatima alayhi salam. Imam Ali alayhi salam was not irresponsible in any way, as some like to portray him. The Imam had a will from the Messenger of God. And the Imam, for the sake of Allah, had to be patient. Just like Imam Zain al-Abidin had to be patient, seeing all those women and children from Karbala to Sham being physically assaulted. But Imam Zain al-Abidin, what, he lacked courage? God forbid. Can you say that about the Imam? How come he never tried to fight? Because he was instructed by God not to fight. That was a moment where Imam Zain al-Abidin had to be patient. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, in those first few minutes, yes, he was instructed by God to be patient, to compile the Quran. But then after that, yes, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, he did rush to the scene. But what happened to Lady Fatima salawatullahi alayha? She stood up for the Imam of her time, but she paid a very heavy price. My dear brothers and sisters, on a night like tonight, Medina was quiet. The cries of Lady Fatima were no longer being heard. For 2 months, she was constantly crying about the injustice, about the departure of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi, about the Imam of her time being violated. But tonight, Medina was quiet. In her will to Imam Ali alayhi salam, Lady Fatima alayhi salam told him, "My beloved cousin, I feel that I am departing soon, and there are things in my heart that I want to share with you." The Imam alayhi salam says, "Yes, Fatima, tell me, what is it that you want?" First of all, she tells him, "Oh Ali, forgive me for any shortcomings. Forgive me for any shortcomings. If I have any shortcomings, I want you to forgive me. Never did I lie. Never did I betray you." Fatima, with all her purity, she asked Imam Ali for forgiveness. "Fatima, you had no shortcomings, but this is your humbleness." Imam Ali begins to cry. He says, "Fatima, I swear by Allah, I never saw anything negative from you. Never did one day you anger me or upset me. And now, Fatima, now that I see you departing me, I feel the pain of the departure of the Prophet. Now you renewed my sorrow. Now you renewed my grief." And then he says, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un." What a difficult tragedy. What a painful event that I have to go through. What a sorrowful moment I have to experience now. This is the state of Imam Ali and Lady Fatima when she was giving him the will. Then she told him, "Oh Ali, my will is that you bury me at night and you pray on me secretly. All those who oppressed me, I do not want them to be in my funeral. This is something that I make the request from you." The Imam alayhi salam told her, "Ya bint Rasulullah, yes, I will honor that request. Anything else? Yes, ya Abul Hasan. When you bury me, come on my grave and read the Quran." Brothers and sisters, know the value of Quran. Fatima, with all her greatness, she tells Imam Ali that when you read the Quran on my grave, that gives me consolation. Her final will: "Look after my children, Hassan and Hussein, Zainab, Kulthum. After me, they could be harassed. Maybe people can say something negative to them. I want you to be there for them, ya Abul Hasan." The Imam alayhi salam promised her that he would honor all this will. The Imam alayhi salam, then that night, he buries Lady Fatima. A feeling of loneliness encompasses Amir al-Mu'mineen. The Imam feels very lonely. The darkness of the night, everyone was asleep. Imam Ali in Nahj al-Balagha, he tells us how he was feeling when he buried Lady Fatima. He says, "When I buried her, I looked at the grave of the Prophet from the distant. And then I said, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulallah. عني وعن ابنتك النازلة في جوارك. Peace be upon you, Ya Rasulullah, on my behalf and on behalf of your daughter who is now your guest. She has now been buried in her grave. And she is by your grave. And too soon, too fast, she joined you, Ya Rasulullah. Then Imam Ali, the mountain of patience, he says, Ya Rasulullah, قل عن صفيتك صبري وضعف عن سيدة النساء تجلدي. Ya Rasulullah, I have lost patience for what happened to Sayyidat al-Nisa and to your daughter. I no longer have the patience to cope with this tragedy. Ya Rasulullah, Zahra has been taken. She's been snatched from me. Ya Rasulullah, there were many things in her heart that she did not share with anyone. Now that she has joined you, Ya Rasulullah, you ask her, you tell her what happened to her, and she will tell you how your nation, your ummah, conspired against her, how they usurped her rights. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib is overcome with sadness. This is his beloved wife, his beloved partner in life, and he has to bury her with his own bare hands. After Imam Ali had buried Lady Fatima, the Imam alayhi salam takes a short nap. In his nap, the Imam alayhi salam sees Lady Fatima. She tells him, Ya Abu al-Hasan, I thank you for executing my will and thank you for reading the Quran on my grave. But oh, Abu al-Hasan, just now my daughter Zainab in our house, she woke up in the middle of the night and she's seeing my empty place and she's crying. Abu al-Hasan, go to the house right now. Comfort Zainab. Look at the heart of Lady Fatima. It's always with her daughter Zainab. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, he rushes from where he was. He goes to the room of Lady Fatima, to the house of Lady Fatima. He sees young Zainab. Maybe she was about 4 years old at this time. And she's looking at the empty corner of where her mother would pray. And she was crying. Imam Ali alayhi salam was heartbroken to see his daughter Zainab in so many tears. Oh believers, Fatima alayhi salam could not handle her daughter cry by seeing her empty space. What would have Fatima done if she were there present on the day of Ashura? When Zainab saw the head of her brother Aba Abdullah on a spear. And when Shimr ibn al-Jawshan, he would hit her with the back of the spear. What would have Fatima done? Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wa sayalamu alladhina zalamu ala Muhammadin. Hayya munqalabin yanqalibun. Wal'aqibatu lilmuttaqin. Raise your hands. Today is the martyrdom of Lady Fatima. Raise your hands, brothers and sisters. I know you all.